Okay, so in today's class, firstly we will going to learn lambda functions. Okay, so suppose that at some place we don't want to create a big function. Okay, we just want to create a simple function that can be written in a single line. Okay, so these lambda functions are just those functions. It is also called as anonymous functions. Anonymous functions because it don't has any name. Okay, whenever you create any function in Python or in any programming language, then we should have a name that we should give to the function. But lambda function has the functionality that you can create a function without the name. That's why they are called as anonymous functions. Okay, so and they are just a small function and it will be always written in a single line. Okay, so similarly, as like simple functions, lambda functions also take arguments and it can also return some values. Okay, so this is the very simple syntax of lambda function. Is the first we need to write lambda, that is a keyword we must need to write, and then arguments that we need to pass, and then we have expression. Expression is something that this lambda function will calculate and it will return. Okay, so you can see that here we don't have any name that we have given to our lambda functions. Okay, suppose that we want to create a simple function where we pass the value of a and it will return a plus 10. Okay, so now we are writing x is equal to lambda a, and then a will be used as the argument. You can see that if you compare this from this syntax, then we have lambda a and then it is returning a plus 10. Now if you call x 5, then it will give you 15. Okay, 5 will be passed as the argument and it will return 5 plus 10, means it will return you 15. Again, suppose that if you have two arguments like a and b, so you can also pass a and b, and then suppose that we are returning here a star b. Okay, now if you call x 5 6, so 5 will be passed as the a value of, and 6 will be passed as the b value. Now it will give you 5 star 6, means it will return you 30. So this is a very simple approach of creating lambda functions. So these functions, lambda functions, are really very easy. Okay, now if you want to see the example of this, just give me 1 minute. Okay, Now suppose that we want to create a simple lambda function that will x is equal to lambda. Suppose that here we are passing a and we are returning here a plus 10. Okay. Now if you call this lambda function, and here it will call like same as we call the function. So we need to pass argument that was supposed to pass. So we need to pass here a. So suppose that the value of a we are passing here 10. Now it should return what? A plus 10. That will it will return 10 plus 10 means it should return you 20. Sorry for this, actually it's currently working very slow today because it is not I didn't shut down this in the last 6 to 7 days. When it is not running the program, just wait for 1 minute. Yes, now it is giving you 20. Okay, so that was supposed to, that was the supposed output. Okay, now suppose that we are writing a different lambda function, lambda x, and then we are passing two or three arguments x, y, z, and we are returning here x plus y plus z. Okay, so now you can call this lambda function like this. And then you can call this like this, and here we need to pass the value of x and y and z. Now if you run it is print, it is giving you 6. Okay, so one way of calling this is also like this. You can see that here we didn't give this lambda function a name. Currently we are in this example we are giving the lambda function a name. Okay, that was the name as x. So now we are calling this x10, and now you cannot means if you want you cannot give the lambda function a name. So this is all works. Yes, in the real world application, lambda functions are used where you don't need to means create a function that is you. Basically, what is the application of functions? Functions only we create when we want to use the function again and again. Means functions are used for reusability principle. Means reusability principle is what? Means if your some part of code you want to use in the different parts of program, then only then we should create a function. Suppose that if we are calling, if we want to use the function for only one time, then there is no need of creating the functions. Functions should be used at least two or more places, then and only then we should create function. But again, if you don't want to create function somewhere, means only you want some functionality, that means you will pass something and it will return something. In that scenario, you can create a lambda function and you can pass that. Okay, so suppose we have something called as mapping filtering. In the mapping and filtering, we use the lambda function. Currently, I'm not giving the example of mapping and filtering. So these are just a part of advanced part. So first we need to have the knowledge of map and this filtering. So we will, just for the knowledge purpose, you should know this lambda function. And in the next examples, I will give you how can we use the lambda function in the real world scenario. Okay. Means x, y, z, you can use anything like x, y, z. We are giving the arguments here, means in the lambda function. Yeah, so if you talk about lambda functions, I told you about the functions that whenever you create any we pass any parameter in the function, then we try to give a descriptive name to the parameters. But in the lambda function, you should not use descriptive name. Try to use small names like x, y, z, because there is no any application of this. Okay, only we are, means lambda functions should be as small as possible, then we have the benefit of lambda function.
Okay, sir.
Okay, that's why we have used x, y, z. But in the previous examples of creating function, I never used x, y, z. Okay, so now we are going to complete in the recursive functions. I have given you only one example, but now I'm giving you one more example of recursive function. So as I told you, recursive function are those function that calls itself. Okay, so suppose that we want to, and I also explained that in the recursive function we should always have a base case, that is the termination case. Suppose that if function is calling itself, then this repetition will happen for the infinite time. If you don't have a some condition where this function calling can stop, so this means this case where we stop our calling again and again this recursive function, this is called as a base case. Okay, base case is somewhere we know our value. Okay, suppose that if you want to create a function for calculate the factorial of 4, factorial of 5, similarly factorial of n, we want to create a program for factorial of n, we will write what? Def a factorial. Okay, and this def gave factorial pass here n. Okay, we know that what is the value of 1 factorial, it is what? 1. What is the value of 2 factorial? It is 1 star 2. If I ask you what is the value of n factorial, you can say that it is n star n minus 1 factorial. Am I right or not? Can we write like this? Value of 1 factorial is what? 1, 2 factorial is 1 star 2, and then the value of 3 factorial is what? It is 3 star 2 factorial. Similarly, we can write value of n factorial is n star n minus 1 factorial. So we can write def get factorial. So we can write if n is equal to 1. So we know that if n is equal to 1, we know that the value of 1 factorial is what? 1. Okay, so this is called as base case. Base case is nothing but where we know our value. Okay, or you can also like write like if n is equal to 2, then here we need to write return 1. If n is equal to 2, we know that the value of 2 factorial is what? 2. So we can return here return 2. So you can have multiple base cases also, but I will tell that we should have only one base case, as I explained. So now we don't encounter the base condition, then we can write return n star get n factorial of n minus 1. Okay, so this get factorial function is calling itself. So this, that's why they are called as recursive function. So this function is calling itself. But if we don't have base condition, then what will happen? This calling will have an infinite loop. This will call itself, then again it will call itself, then again. So it will happen in an infinite loop. So if this loop will terminate if the value of n will be down to 1, or if the value of n will be down to 2. Firstly, suppose we are passing 5, then it will be 5 star get n factorial 4. Then it will be get n factorial 3, then 2. When we encounter 2, this value will return 2 and this program will terminate then. Okay. So now, if you call this print get factorial, suppose that we want to get the value of 4 factorial. It is returning you 24, and we know that the value of 4 factorial is what? 4 star 3 star 2 star 1. So it is 24. So then you can, this is the second example of recursive function. Again, we can also have an example of recursive function. Suppose that if somebody asks you, call the sum of the series up to n, 1 star 1 plus 2 star 2 plus 3 star 3 up to n star n. Okay, so this problem can be broken into like this. If the value is 1 star 1, then the answer is 1. If the value is 2 star 2, then the answer is 2. So you can write here, so this is just a square sum. So we can write here def get square sum, get square sum. And what will be the base condition? Base condition is what? Where we know our value. So you can write here, if n is equal to 1, then we need to return what? Return 1 star 1. If n is equal to 2, then what should we return? Return 2 star 2 plus 1 star 1 plus 2 star 2. So these are the base conditions. So you can write multiple base conditions also. Else, if these are not true, then we need to return what? N star n plus get square sum of n minus 1. Is clear, everyone? If somebody asks you what is the sum of square up to n, so you will write what? N star n plus what? Then you will what? Sum up to n minus 1. So this is the process you will do. It's like this, means this program will be completed like this. Okay, means up to 1, we know that up to 1 the value is what? Means up to 1 the value is 1 star 1. Up to 2 the value is what? 1 star 1 plus 2 star 2. Similarly, the value up to n will be what? N star n plus sum of n minus 1. So if you have confusion, you can also write this. If the value is 3, then you can write here 3 star 3 plus sum up to 2. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Did you get this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now, if you run this program, and then if you call here, get squared sum up to 4. Get squared sum up to 4. Then you will get what? Suppose that we are just calling get sum of square 3, then it will return what? 1, what should be the answer? Just running this. So it is returning you 14. So the value should be what? 1 star 1, that is 1, plus 2 star 2, okay, then plus 3 star 3. So it will be around 9 plus 4, 13 plus 1, 14. 13 plus 1, 14. So it is giving you the correct output. Similarly, if somebody asks you, give the sum of the series up to like this, two sum of the series, one is star one plus two star two star two plus three star three plus four star four. Similarly, if somebody asks you sum of the series up to sum of the series of cube up to n, it will be n star n. So you can simply write here def get cube sum I think you all can answer now. If n is 1, so return what? 1 star 1 star 1 else we need to return what? N star n plus get sum get cubic sum up to n minus 1. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
So now if you want to run this print get cubic sum, and suppose that if somebody asks you up to 4, you can call this, it is returning you 100. I don't know what is the exact answer, so it is returning you 100. So now you can so similarly any sum you can so suppose that if sum is like this, series is like this, like 1 star 2 plus 2 star 3 plus 3 star 4 plus 4 star 5. Okay, up to what? Up to n star n plus 1. I think now you all can answer. We will write what? If def get series sum up to n, then we know if n is equal to 1, then the answers would be what? 2, means 1 star 2, otherwise return what? N star n plus. Now you can think that what will be the previous of previous one, so you need to write the previous one. So it will be n minus 1 and then it will be n minus 2 and n minus 1 and then n. Okay. So now you can write here n star n plus 1 plus what? Note get cubic sum, get series sum of n minus 1. Okay, now suppose that we just want to call this for up to 2 times. So we'll write here print get 3 sum, and suppose that here we are passing 3. Not 3, firstly we are passing here 2. Okay. Okay, sorry, here we need to write return. It is returning you 8. Now you can see, check that 3 star 2 plus 1 star 2 will be what? 8, 6 plus 2, 8. So similarly, you can write your program. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So this is the application of recursive functions. So there is one very famous scenario where recursive functions are used, is called as binary searching. Okay, so in the binary searching, we use the recursive function. So you just try to use this binary search recursive function in the binary searching. So what is binary searching? So binary searching is something, suppose that if you have a list, if you have an array, okay, so this is a sorted array like 1, 3, 5, 6, 7, and then we have like 45, then 67, 78, then 90. So what binary searching does, suppose that you want to check any value that is present in this list or not. Okay, so just think that we don't have any function to get that. We want to write a program for that. So what binary searching says that, so suppose that if you have a number to get, suppose that you want to check 7 is present or not. So what you will do, firstly you will find the mid element. So what is the mid element of this? So 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9, so the mid element is basically the 7. Okay, so we do what, we check that if this number is less than or equal to, so basically suppose that we want to check 6, then it will be easy to understand. So the mid element is 7. Now you will check that if this number is less than 7, then we need to find only in this part of the list. If this number is greater than 7, then we need to find in this part of the list. So the binary searching tells that divide this list, means every time, into half, so that your program will be now easy, means the speed of your program will be fast for searching. Okay, so this is binary searching. So how this is implemented, means you will do what, every time you will check with the mid element. If the element that you are searching is less than the mid element, then you will look into the left half. If this is greater, then you will look into the right half. If this is equal to the mid element, then you will return the value. So means what will happen, so first time suppose that, so this will work out. So firstly you will mid element will be 7. Okay, now you will take this part of the list only. Means if this number is less than this, then we need to look, we will also leave this, we will look into this. Now we'll divide again the we will find the left, means middle one. So you can see that middle element we don't have, so any middle element you can take, either this or this. Okay, so suppose that you are checking that you have taken this mid element. Now you know that this element is now present here, so now we will take only this part of this. Now again we will check for the middle element. So now we have two elements only, so middle element anyone we take, so 5. If this value is greater than 5, then we need to check here, so we'll find 6. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes sir.
So you try to write a program for this, otherwise I will give the solution for this. So this is called as binary searching. Now time is 6:44. So I am just giving you the basic idea of object oriented programming. So now so we have lots of project to discuss. Okay, so 3 project, credit card, DNA and calculator project, and one is school database based project. So we have 4 projects for discussion. So I will have a day that we will have only the discussion about the project. So either we can make this on today, we don't have time, so it is already 6:45. We will complete the project discussion on tomorrow's class. Okay, so today I am giving you the continuing the object oriented programming. Okay, so what is object oriented programming? I told you that this is a different approach of solving the program. So previously we have only the functional programming approach, where we create several functions and we use those functions in our purpose. But I show my code base for read my course, where you can see that related functions we kept it one place. Okay, and that function, and one more thing is state. So state is present in object-oriented programming. So state is what? State is something, some value that is basically getting maintained in the object. So what is object? We will explain this later. Just try to understand what is object-oriented programming? It is one of the popular approach to solve a programming problem is by creating object. So this is known as object-oriented programming. So object-oriented programming tells what? Everything around us is a project, object. Everything around us is an object, and object will have two things. So first will be attribute and second will be behavior. So first means this just don't think about programming here, just think about the real world. So in the real world, everything is object. An object has two characteristics. So first is attribute and second is behavior. Attribute is just something that is basically defines that is basically the property of the object. If you talk about man, so what are the attributes of man? Height, color. Okay, so height and color, these can be attribute of the man. Similarly, if you talk about anything like suppose that if you talk about building, so what will be the attribute of building? Building will have height, number of floors, okay, cost, what is the cost of building, and then color of the building. So these can be the attribute of the object. Now behavior. So behavior are functionality or operations that object performs. So if you talk about man, so man does what? We can talk, we can sing, okay, we can run. So talking, singing, running, these are the behavior of the object. Okay, so if somebody asks you what is object, so you can simply define that object are means if means in the programming context, it is the very simple definition of object is objects are the blueprint of the object are something that has two characteristics, that is first is attribute and behavior. Means object is the made of object is made of attributes and behavior. Okay, and what is the attributes? Attributes is the I already explained you, attributes are the just characteristics or means things that basically attach to the object. Behavior are the functionality that object performs. Now if we talk about a rabbit, let's say I have given an example of rabbit. So what will be the attributes of the rabbit? Name, suppose that we have given a rabbit a name. Age can be also the attribute. Color. And what will the behavior? Running, eating. So these will be the behavior of the object. So now this principle basically is getting followed in the object-oriented programming. So object-oriented programming says that everything is object, and object will have two things, attribute and behavior. Now how we use these attribute and behaviors? So for working with object-oriented programming, we create classes. So classes are what? Class is the blueprint of object, means class defines a object. To define an object, we create a class. Very simple definition. Class is the what? Class is the blueprint of object. Okay. Now, if you want to create a simplest class in Python, so you will give a name to the class. So suppose that we want to create a class for rectangle. So this, we are writing class in the syntax, and then rectangle, and then we are pass is we are writing, we don't want to write anything. So you can write here pass. Okay. Now if you want to create the object of this rectangle, so you can create by writing rectangle 1 is equal to rectangle. So by this way, you can create the object of the rectangle. Okay. Now if somebody asks you what is rectangle, so you will say that rectangle is a class. What is rectangle 1? Rectangle 1 is an object. Rectangle 1 is the object of rectangle class. Okay. I can also say that rectangle 1 is the instance of rectangle class. Okay. So now if you want to create a rectangle class in Python, then you can simply write here. Always the name of the class should be start with the capital case letter. So we'll write here class and then rectangle. Okay. And here we don't want to write anything, so we can write here pass. If you want to create the object of this, so you can create the object of this by writing rectangle one is equal to rectangle. This is class and this is object. You will not return you anything. You can run the program. Now you can check the type of this. If you print the type of this rectangle one, this is just a what? This is just a variable. So if you print the type of this variable, so it will be, it will have the class as rectangle. You can see that it is printing you rectangle. So the class is what? Rectangle. So this is a very simple way of creating a class in Python. Now I told you class has two things, attributes and behavior. So I'll ask you what can be the attributes of a rectangle. So can somebody give me the answer? What can be the attributes of rectangle?
Length.
Yes, very correct. So the attributes of rectangle will be what? Length and width, or length and breadth. So I have written 2 points here. Class attributes are attributes which are owned by the class, and we define class attributes outside all the methods. Okay, so always you define the attributes outside all the methods. That methods are the functions inside the class. Usually they are placed at the top, right below the class header. So you can see that this is the class header, means class rectangle, this class header, and all the attributes will be defined below this class header. Now you can see that adding the attribute is very simple. Just it is like a variable. So light here, length is equal to 10 and width is equal to 20. So these are now the attribute of this rectangle. Okay. So now if you want to get this value of this, so simply attributes are the variables, okay, that are created inside the class. Now if you want to attach attributes here, then you can write here. Length is equal to 10 and width is equal to 20. Okay. Now, if you want to get the value of this length and width, then you will write here what? Then rectangle 1 dot length. It will print the length of, it is printing you 10. Similarly, you can also get the width. So you will write here what? Print, and then rectangle 1 dot width. So it will print what? 20. Okay. If you want to change the value of this, you can also change. Write what? Rectangle 1 dot length is equal to supported 100. Now if you print rectangle 1 dot length, then you will get what? 100. Okay. Is this clear, everyone? You can create multiple copy, multiple object of a class. Now you can see that we have rectangle, then we can also create a rectangle 2. That will be the second object of this rectangle class. So right here, rectangle. Now if you print rectangle 2 dot length, can somebody guess what will be the output here? Means we have changed the value of rectangle 1 dot length, that is 100, but if you call here rectangle 2 dot length, so what will be the, initially the value of length was 10, we have changed this by 100. Can you guess the output now?
10 only, sir.
Yes, 10 only. Why? because I told you object have state, is on state. Okay, when you have created the object of rectangle, okay, means rectangle, sorry, where we have created rectangle 2, yeah, here. So now previously we have created the rectangle 1 object and we have changed the state of the rectangle 1 by changing the length attribute. Now we are creating a different object of rectangle, but this length will be changed for this rectangle 1 object only, but this rectangle 2 length of this rectangle 2 object will be the same as it was at the time of creating the object, then it will be 10. Now if you print, you can see that in the first case it is printing you 100 and secondly it is printing you 10. Okay, so this is the benefit of the class. Class can have state. So now if you have any doubt, you can